This is Kilimo Bora. My name is Caleb Odongo Koyo and I have Cynthia Wairimu on the show today. Today we are having a deep conversation on fish farming and our guest today is one Raila Augustine Odhiambo. Welcome to the studios.
Thank you.
Okay, so Augustine, yes. How are you?
I'm fine.
How are enjoying you? Your day?
I'm good.
Very well. So Augustine, what is fish farming?
Fish farming is rearing of African fish or rearing of fish as well. It involves culturing of various species of fish within a certain environment that is created or within a certain environment that is not created. That is within a cultured pond or within environment created within greenhouses as per the technology of today or within tanks and within the inside the greenhouses.
Okay. Yeah. So Augustine, how do you choose the fish to put in these greenhouses?
Fish to be put in greenhouses depends on the species that is being selected and the survival species in a certain area. In each and every location, an ecotype is chosen for the certain fish in that location. For example, we have the Nile tilapia, that is orange mass niloticus, and the African catfish. To select a fish in a farmer has to decide or has to go and check first what the market demand requires. For example, for a farmer to keep Nile tilapia fish, he has to go and check on the acceptance by the farmers by the market or other farmers in the market. For example, when you look at this fish called catfish, the catfish is not mostly accepted by people because the head, that people look at the head as if it's snake-like. Look at that. And mostly before it is around 6 months when it is mature, before it is taken to the market, you have to cut the parts, remove the head to remain the other part, that is the flesh.
So Augustine, basically what the farmer is going to do is to look at the market. So what he does is dictated by
the market demand.
The people demand.
Yeah.
So do you think Kenyans have embraced fish farming from where you sit?
Yeah, Kenyans have embraced fish farming. The government, the economic stimulus project that the government encouraged, began with duck ponds and introduced fish farming to all the nation, that is Kenya. Each and every constituency and each and every county was given a fish farming project. The government dug the ponds, introduced the fingerlings to the farmers, but there are some cases that happened that the government could not follow up with the farmers, and therefore it led to the deterioration of the farming of fish.
So let's narrow down to fish farming here in Igeto University in Njoro campus. How many ponds do we have to do this business?
Igeto University has 8 ponds.
8 ponds of fish.
The ponds are doing well, but we need to acclimatize the temperatures within the ponds to improve the ponds.
What's the best temperature for fish farming?
Around 28 to 30 degrees Celsius.
Oh, very well. So what got you started on fish farming?
Being an expert in animal sciences, I got a lot of interest in fish farming because there are still the fish farming has not been potentially exploited.
So what changes do you think should be put in place except the changing of, you've called it acclimatization?
Yeah, acclimatization of temperatures.
Very well. So what are the changes do you think are needed?
One, we need to work on the various ecotypes of fish to grow.
So when you talk of ecotypes, what do you mean?
When talking of ecotypes, I talk of fish from different regions or from different areas that are adapting to certain areas and certain conditions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, very well. So
we have 8 ponds in Igeto University.
Yes.
How do we stock the ponds and what are some of the species of fish we have in there?
Igeto University rears mainly the Nile tilapia fish. And the stocking of ponds starts from the hatchery.
Yeah.
That's where the eggs and there's something known as sexing that is carried out within the hatchery.
Yeah.
To produce fingerlings either of monosex or of polysex, whereby you produce single sex, meaning you have one single sex species in a pond. Yeah.
All that is done in here.
All that is done here.
So just simply females in one pond and males in the other pond.
Yeah,
okay, very nice.
And you start from the eggs.
Yeah.
Then you go from the eggs in the hatchery. The eggs hatch into hide hover, which is found within the hatchery. Then that takes around 2 days. Then from there, they hatch into halavings, then to the fingerlings that we do stock in our ponds.
Okay.
Yeah. Tell us something brief about the breeding of these fish in here.
Fish breeding in this place has been a problem, as I said before, because of temperature regulations. And the temperature here is around 24 degrees Celsius, which is very low. And therefore, the challenge is that for you to carry out breeding, you have to either eat the water to give the, to acclimatize the fish with the temperatures that are required for the fish to survive in order to carry out breeding. Yeah. And again, you have to identify your breeding stock that you want to carry out and use for breeding. Because you remove the semen from the male and remove the eggs or the ova from the female. And then you carry out the process of sexing.
Are we doing this for, are students able to consume this fish, or are we just doing it for learning purposes?
Fish, we do it for learning purposes, and also we do it for sales.
For sales.
Igato University produces fingerlings for sales.
Oh, very well. So do what's the demand, what's the market demand here at Egerton University? Is it with the staff, is it with the students, is it with the eateries that we have here?
The farmers come to Egerton University to inquire concerning the fingerlings. So the fingerlings we sell to the farmers within this locality, but there's still potential to provide more fingerlings to the entire nation.
And then we, you said we have 8 points to make this conversation more relevant to a farmer who will be listening, who is currently listening. How do we go about constructing the ponds? How expensive doing, let's say for example, when I want to do the maximum cash I can use to do one pond, basically range?
It ranges from around 15,000 to 30,000.
15,000 to 30,000. And we have also people to employ to do the pond.
Yeah, the labor. So that might be a pond of 8 by 15.
Yeah. How many fish should we have inside there?
You can stock around 2,000 fish, but it depends on the species that you're stocking within the pond.
Speaking about stocking, how do we stock the fish in Egerton University, or do we just go through the process you mentioned earlier about the fingerlings? And
yeah, we undergo the same process here. From the hatchery, we carry the fish using is a stocking, I do call it stocking materials that you use to put the fish, the fingerlings into the ponds.
So that's basically what we do.
So Augustine, what are the challenges that come with fish farming?
The challenges that come with fish farming, one, there's poor marketing for the fish products by the farmer. And by the, most people do not accept fish, especially people, the acceptability among people is still low.
Why do you think this is?
This is because of people have not been given enough knowledge concerning fish rearing and fish eating and fish farming as such.
So let's just look at the Kenyan market.
Yeah.
People love fish.
Yeah.
They love fish.
Yeah.
So where is this fish coming from? If there is demand, then there has to be market.
The most of fish come from lakes, Lake Victoria. That is from freshwater lakes, and others from the sea. Yeah.
And then Augustine, you say that people don't have the information about this
lack of technical know-how.
And then you are an expert in this field.
Yeah.
What are you doing to ensure that the farmer and the guys on the street have the relevant information about all this process?
We have been offering extension through Egerton University. And through these extensions, we try to educate farmers on the importance of fish farming. Fish is very essential, especially for the young, the young born.
So you're talking about nutrients here?
Nutrients, yeah. The amino acids that you get in fish. You cannot get them in some plant species, but you get them in fish.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this brings a problem when it comes to vegetarians, right?
Yeah. You find that fish is very essential for the brain development. Very essential. It's a mineral and amino acids that are essential for brain development.
So is that where the omega-3 comes in?
That's where the omega-3 comes in.
Which is important for?
Which is important generally for development of the brain.
The brain.
Yeah.
So without these, then a child is in trouble.
Very big trouble.
Very big trouble.
Very wrong.
That's amazing. Then we also have, speaking about the
another challenge that comes in is we don't have capacity in terms of funding that will enable the government or the institution to do proper fish farming.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's demand from farmers. As the government came out with the stimulus project of making ponds for the farmers, stocking the ponds, but the government failed to follow up the ponds through extension services. And therefore, you find that most people are interested, but they don't have that information.
Oh, so what you mean to say is, what you mean to say is, the government did give these ponds, but they didn't give the technical know-how of how to manage them.
Yeah.
Which now is bringing problems with farmers, because now, okay, they're there. So what next? Is that the problem? Is that one of the challenges?
That's one of the challenges.
Oh, okay.
In the nationwide and even here at the university.
Okay. Yeah. So now that now brings us to technical know-how.
Technical know-how.
How should we, how should these farmers be educated? What do you suggest?
There is that information that one, we should have a center like INSEP where we are with our ponds. We should be inviting farmers for the trainings.
Okay.
We train them
at
a certain cost that we say, which is which can be catered for by the farmers.
Okay.
Yeah. This will enable the farmers to have enough information and enough knowledge on how to do out the fish farming.
Okay.
We should be. Are we really doing that? Or have we started yet?
We have started. We've started.
So and there are a few programs here and there?
There are a few programs, especially on fingerlings. We are producing fingerlings and we sell.
We sell.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Then, really, I want us to go straight into the bacterial and fungal diseases that maybe can affect the fish in the ponds.
Yeah, in Egerton, we have not experienced such kind of diseases.
Yeah.
But there are diseases that occur in ponds.
Mm.
Okay.
Like this black rot that affects the gills of the fish. We find fish are rotting from the gills due to reduction in oxygen in water.
Okay.
Yeah. So when that happens, there's death among the fish stock.
Hold it a bit. You say reduction of oxygen in water,
yeah.
Meaning the we not only regulate the temperatures at 24 degrees Celsius, but also look at the oxygen in there.
Yeah.
How do we do that?
We use checking oxygen in water. There is an instrument known as oximeter that we use to check the level of oxygen in water. And remember, if the stock is high, there is less oxygen in water, meaning that will depend on the size of the pond. If the pond is small and stock high, the level of oxygen will be low, because the fish will be competing over this small oxygen that is found in the ponds. The stocking carrying capacity will be high as compared to the oxygen that will be there. And again, the feeding. You find that the fish now be competing for the small resources of feed that you're feeding. And as a result of that, that will bring about competition.
Okay.
So, what's the number of fish you advise a farmer to stock in a how do I call it? Let's say I have a pond that is not so large.
8 by 5.
Yeah.
Or you said what's the standard size
15,
of a pond?
8 by 15.
8 by 15.
Yeah.
Feet or inches.
Feet. 8 by 15.
Okay.
Feet.
8 by 15 feet.
Yeah.
So again, I think it depends on the size of the fish. So that you can talk about now how many fish you can put in there.
Yeah, it depends on the species of the fish.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
For example, you look at catfish.
Mm-hmm.
Catfish can grow to a larger size and larger cages. And stocking of catfish will require that you use an earthen pond. That is a pond that is not covered at below, because these are always a carnivorous species of fish that feed on even worms or those what we know as zooplanktons that are found within the ponds.
Then there was a conversation about regulating the temperature, and one of the methods we see you can be able to achieve that is by having the greenhouse within the ponds. This seemed to be a bit technical. Tell us something about that.
Introduction of greenhouses to cover ponds is that the temperatures within the greenhouse are always regulated.
Yeah.
For example, you'll find that fish is always feeding well at night.
At night.
When the temperatures are cool.
Are cool.
Yeah.
Mm. Because that's why most people go fishing at night.
At night.
Yeah.
And you'll find that in this region, at night is always very cold.
Mm.
And the temperatures are always very low.
Mm.
And if the ponds are open, then automatically you're going to experience a low growth rate within the fish.
Mm.
Yeah. They'll take time to feed and they'll take time to grow.
Mm.
There's below feed conversion ratio for the fish.
So far I've not seen a greenhouse here constructed over a pond at Egerton University. Does that explain why we have low production?
That is exactly explain why we have low production.
But then, like we say, for you to run a whole process, you need cash. Perhaps you don't have enough cash to do this.
Yeah, that also comes in.
Mm.
And again, apart from that, the challenge that comes in is the feed that we feed, the fish feed, is not properly formulated. Most feeds, most people who are getting the fish feed are not experts in the feed formulation. They're not animal scientist experts.
Yeah.
And therefore, you find they make poor quality feeds. Yeah. Which, when they feed, cannot give us the right percentage of 24% crude protein for the fish. Depending on the stages, we feed fish depending on the stages that are there.
Mm.
And the fish feed should have a crude protein depending on the level of stages.
Mm.
Yeah. For example, you can feed as high as 30% crude protein for the fingerlings of around 2 weeks old.
And then where should you get the right feeds then?
If you have the good manufacturers that we know, like Dominion Farm in Kisumu. They do good feed.
We don't have any at Egerton.
We have our feed mill at Egerton, at the Incipia.
Yeah.
Yeah. We can also formulate our good feed from here.
But we are not yet doing that.
We are not yet doing that.
So we get them from Kisumu or from Nairobi.
We are doing it here. We are trying to do it here.
Mm.
But I still believe that those who are doing it are not properly
trained to do
trained
that.
To that.
Mm.
Okay. Okay, let's hope that they will get the proper training and that at least there is knowledge out there.
Yeah.
Okay. So do you think fish is expensive or do you think it's cheap? Or do you think it's affordable?
It's affordable in Kenya.
Uh-huh.
It's affordable. It's very, very affordable.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what it takes to rear fish? What I'm talking of, the resources that go into the rearing, are there returns?
There are good returns in fish farming.
Are there good returns in fish farming. Okay.
A kg of fish goes for around 200 to 300 shillings.
Mm-hmm.
A kg of fish.
Mm. So if you look at, say, 12 of them, but you talked of a capacity of how many?
For a pond, for an 8x15 pond, you can stock around 2,000.
2,000.
Yeah.
And so the capital required is not as much?
Yeah, not as much, because a fingerling goes for 10 shillings.
10 shillings?
Yeah.
Okay.
So if you stock 2,000, you'll be stocking at a rate of 20,000.
Uh-huh. And at the same time, this fish are going to take how long? 6 months?
It's going to take 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
We carry out... we harvest when fish is already table size fish. And that takes around 6 months. So we can carry out twice annually.
Very well.
Yeah.
So any other challenges you can let us know about fish farming? You've talked about funds, you've talked about the technical know-how, you've talked about greenhouses and fish ponds under them. What else? And the diseases?
Yeah.
Except now you called it the black rot?
Black rot.
Yes. Is there any other that you feel can affect fish very easily?
No, there are few.
So in short, fish are, what should I say, low maintenance?
Yeah, depending on the management.
Or depending on the management.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Mr. Raila, should I only have the pond? Can't I also have this fish in a tank at home, inside some structure? Because not every farmer out there can afford a pond.
Yeah.
Mm.
Because farmers are using fish tanks.
Mm.
There are tanks to rear fish within their houses. But this will also depend on the region that you're doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's say you are in Kisumu or Nyanza.
Yeah.
Mm.
In Nyanza, we do fish rearing in tanks, but these tanks are round and have a diameter of around 3 meter by 1 meter in height.
Okay.
Yeah. That can carry a maximum of 200 fingerlings.
Yeah, 200 fingerlings.
Okay. I remember a friend of mine, although this was goldfish.
Yeah.
He had these black tanks.
Yeah, black tanks.
Yes. So he had connected, it was sort of an aquarium. Because the water was continuously running. It wasn't stagnant.
Yeah.
And there were about 4 or 5 of them in there.
Yeah.
So is that suitable? This is in Nairobi.
In Nairobi,
actually, Georgia, to be specific.
It is suitable.
It's suitable.
But this will depend upon the farmer. It is suitable.
Okay.
Yeah. So, Mr. Raila, you made us aware that you are launching a project, or how do you call it?
It's a project of recirculating aquaculture technology.
What is the project basically about?
The project involves recirculating water in a system of aquaculture, whereby you have fish tanks. From the fish tanks, you have sedimentation tanks. Then to a biofiltration unit. And this water is pumped back through gravity. There's a pump pumping it first to the biofiltration. Then from the biofiltration system, it goes through the gravity back to the water tanks. Then it comes again.
Why did you come up with this system?
This system have various designs. It has been practiced before in some countries, like South Africa, United States of America, or other countries. But the technology has not been much embraced within Kenya, and therefore, or East Africa as well. And therefore, I looked into this and designed a recirculating aquaculture system, which is known as a closed recirculating aquaculture system.
So, Augustine, I'm curious, as I'm sure many are, what is the aquaculture? What is aquaculture?
Aquaculture is the rearing of fish, both marine and fresh water fish. It involves both freshwater fish and what is known as mariculture. That is the rearing of the salt fish that is in salt environment.
Okay.
Yeah.
But then you have not this.
No, the technology embraces a lot. One, it is practiced in a place that there is no land. The land is inadequate.
There's less land.
Less land, especially in urban areas.
And that's a big problem for a Kenyan farmer.
Yeah. Two, where there's limited water, the water is limited, meaning at a point, the small quantity of water you are having, you can pump it through the system. Then after 1 week, you can release it out to the field. Remember, water from the fish tanks are pumped into a sedimentation tank, then into a recirculating biofiltration unit. The biofiltration unit is made up of microorganisms. These microorganisms convert ammonia that is produced by fish into nitrates. This water is pumped directly to the vegetation field, which means we are supplying a direct manure to the vegetable. At a point, we are having a unit where we collect this water again and pump it back to the fish system, that is the fish tanks. So it recirculates within a given region. So this system has been working together with what's known as aquaponics.
Aquaponics.
And this system can also work with hydroponics. So it's a system that embraces what is known as a technology of today.
Very well. And what amount of capital is required? And on what scale? For instance, you know, the small scale farmers, there are large scale farmers.
The system can be improvised for the small scale farmer and can cost around 300,000 for the small scale farmer. But for intensive recirculating aquaculture system, it costs around 8 million.
Wow.
That is Kenya shillings.
Million Kenya shillings. An intensive system.
$9. But then this is a system that involves a lot of technology.
It involves a lot of technology.
And then we want to make it relevant to the farmer out there, so that somebody who has not much basic education can be able to use it. Don't you think it's going to prove a bigger challenge to you as the guy behind all these things?
This is not a challenge as that, because I've said we can't improvise this kind of system. And when improvised, can come to around 300 for the lower farmer. Because there is tanks that you have to buy, There is aerators that you have to use to provide oxygen to the fish in the tanks. Mm. There is what is known as a biofiltration unit that has to be bought to do this system or can be built. The system of biofiltration unit can also be built using simple materials, grates and gravels that are found within the sea regions.
Yeah. How far are you with this?
I've done one in Maseno, another one in Siaya County. Yeah.
And how is that working out?
Doing very well. Uh-huh. The farmer is using the system to produce fish of various sizes. From 1 week old in one tank, 2 weeks old in another tank, 3 months, that way until the table size fish. So the system allows production of fish at each and every stage.
Very well.
Yeah.
So do you do all this alone, or you have employed some people to help you go over it?
We do it. I don't do it personally. I'm the director of the company that does it.
What's the name of the company?
Modern Agriculture Technologies Kenya.
Yeah.
That's the company.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the company does it very well. I'm the director. We have our technicians on the ground doing that. That we have farmers whom, after doing the project for, we have technical people who now advise the farmer for around 3 months before the project is released to the farmer.
That's actually very good.
Yeah.
That's very good. So apart from this recirculating aquaculture system, there's another project you're working on.
I'm working on a project on assessing the impact and production levels of the African catfish and the Nile tilapia in the Kenyan islands.
Tell us something about that.
Here, I'm trying to compare the species of Nile tilapia, because it has three species. A mozombica species known as Orinchimus nilotica, Orinchimus nilotica, and Orinchimus aereus.
Yeah.
Those are the species of this fish. So I want to look at which species is more adaptable to certain regions of Kenya. The Kenyan islands.
So for instance, you pick these regions and then you pick the three species and then see which one is most adaptable and then work with that.
And work with the crosses.
Go to another region.
Yeah.
Go to another region, the same process.
Same process.
Okay, got it.
Yeah.
So you want to... Why did you come up with this? Why can't you just let us have what we had earlier, then you come and compare the species of fish? Does it sound so it won't make much sense to somebody who just wakes up in the morning, lunchtime, he goes into the hotel and say, hey, mpatie samaki. No.
It is the only way, because one, we are going to produce a fish that is highly resistant to diseases. Two, a fish that can attain the market weight as faster as possible, maybe 5 to 6 months.
5 to 6 months.
Look at that.
Yeah.
Breaking down the even cost.
Yeah.
We are looking at the fish that can adapt to a certain region without giving farmer any hard time when working on it.
Or rather minimal hard time.
Yeah.
So this is also under the company?
This is under the Ingerton University, not the company.
This now is done under Ingerton University.
And even the recirculating aquaculture system we want to do for the university. Under university now.
How far are you on this one?
I have wrote the proposal, everything, and gave to Professor Kai.
Hopefully,
it can work.
It can work.
You'll get
for
a green ticker.
Yeah. Mm.
So, Augustine Raila Odhiambo.
Yes.
You were telling us earlier about recirculating aquaculture system.
Yes.
So, what is this?
This is a technology that embraces circulating a water within a certain tanks, and this water is pumped within a certain units. That is a fish tanks, sedimentation tank, and something known as a biofiltration unit. This system is composed of microorganisms that break down ammonia into nitrates. Then this material is pumped directly to the vegetable field. You think that?
Mm-hmm.
At some point, from the vegetable field, this water is collected again and pumped back the system to the fish tanks.
Mm.
Okay.
Yeah. This system is practiced in an enclosed system within a greenhouse or within an housing. And therefore, this is a system that technology of today that can be embraced. to help in learning, research,
mm-hmm.
and in businesses for then, the small scale.
Augustine, why did you have to come up with this idea? Because it seemed to be involving a lot of technology.
I saw that the Kenyan program of stimulus, the program of stimulus of digging ponds for the farmers and stocking fingerlings to the farmers had a challenge in that these systems of ponds were environmentally influenced.
Mm-hmm.
Were environmentally influenced.
Usually about the external environment.
Yeah, external environment. Okay, okay. The fish ponds were dug in the better region of the country, but they ceased to function.
Yeah.
The fingerlings were stocked. The fingerlings were never vested. They didn't follow up with the extension to recognize or to check on the performance of fish in these ponds.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So you mentioned that for a small-scale farm, it requires about 300,000 in capital.
Yes.
Is that all? For instance, when I have 300,000 with me right now, and I come to your organization, your company, and I tell you, okay, here's what I have. I have 300,000. Will I need any more money after that? What I'm asking is there like a monthly fee or maintenance fee for this recirculating aquaculture system?
There is. Mm-hmm. We charge 10,000 annual per month for extension services.
By extension, you mean?
Extension offering services and consultancies on basis of that structure and on basis of fish farming within the unit.
Okay, very well. You also talked about assessing the impact of two fish species within the Kenyan Islands.
Yes.
So here's my question. Has it worked? Do you have, for you to have thought of this in the proposal, do you think in theory that it would work?
It will work.
Because you've not yet done it, right?
I've not yet done it. Uh-huh. I wrote the project and I believe it will work.
So, for instance, you went looked at the species and their qualities.
Yes.
And you found out that maybe these in this region would be good, bad. Is that what you did so that you can come up with this?
Or that's what happened? I did. And that's what I checked on what was done by the government. And I believe that when we check fish from various regions, these various ecotypes and cross, then we can come with that more adaptable species for certain regions in the country.
Very nice.
So we're very hopeful the process is going to get some green light, then we're going to see more of it in the streets.
We believe so.
So I think on that note, it's only fair we bring the interview today to a close.
Thank you. Before we do, I have a question. Is this happening elsewhere or is this your brainchild?
The design is my brainchild,
uh-huh.
but it happens in various developed countries,
uh-huh. like United States of America. But with fish or with just animals?
With fish.
Okay, very well.
For example, there's sea hawk in South Africa who try to do that kind of farming.
Okay. Yeah. I can see you making a lot of references to South Africa. Does that mean that South Africa is very developed when it comes to fish farming?
They're developed. Uh-huh. I have an expert whom we always communicate from South Africa who does serious fish formulations and serious fish advices and consultancies.
Oh.
Thank you.
Very nice.
So thank you so much for speaking with us, Mr. Raila Augustine. We'll definitely follow up to see how the process is going on.
Thank you.
So
all the best. These are amazing ideas, and we wish you all the best. And thank you so much. I'm hoping that with this interview, if it gets there to the farmers out there, they will at least want the technical know-how so that they can better themselves. And you know, if we better the farming in Kenya, then we better the Kenyans themselves.
I agree. This project is per the vision of Kenya 2030. Thank you.
Okay.
So till next time, I've been your host, Caleb Koyo.
And Cynthia Weremo.
I'm very grateful. Thank you.
Asante sana, Augustine.